It's Absolute Radio. My name is Pete Donaldson, and I don't even need to introduce this man. It's Richard Ashcroft.
But you did anyway.
I did anyway. First things first, I've never seen this room more into a session. I've never seen this room so full. You do draw the crowds, don't you, Richard?
I'm very happy about that. My fans have... we have a really, I'm sure any artist says, oh, we have a deep connection, but
yeah.
I think because my fans weren't led to me by critical praise or zeitgeist riding bullshit, it's the music. And the thing is I've been doing it a while now, and people have realized that stuff that I've done 10, 20 years ago has actually lasted.
Yeah.
And it's, my connection with my fans is on a much deeper level than I could... really go into words about, you know, because the songs have become their songs and it's become part of their life. So and I'm just lucky and happy and privileged to be the guy who wrote them, and I'm looking forward to singing them live, you know what I mean?
And more than that, I think you give a lot of love back. I mean, I can't,
because beyond my family, they're that's all I've got.
Yeah.
Ultimately, it's an empty room, isn't it? It's an empty venue, it's an empty, it's just hundreds of songs in my mind. Do you know what I mean?
I just can't remember the last time one of our artists sort of stood for a good 20 minutes and took pictures with their fans. You know, that doesn't happen very often, you know.
Well, I don't understand why, because I just don't understand that, because it takes 2 seconds. I can understand people's aversion of constantly being stopped and all that.
Yeah.
But for me, it's no sweat, because I could go back to making a junior hacksaw on a rainy Thursday at the age of 13, 14 in an instant.
Mm.
And if you think that a few selfies with people who enjoy your music can compare to the depression that a day like that would bring.
Yeah.
You know, you got to take it right back to when you're young, when you admired someone. How would you feel if they just nipped back behind the black curtain? Thanks very much.
Yeah.
To me, that's not enough. Mm. That's not a connection. You know, they've made the effort. They've come in here,
yeah.
You know, and they've made the effort to come and see me. And most of my fans are great people as well. And if I look on my Instagram sometimes, you know, I'll check out someone's board, and it could be someone in Argentina, Chile, England, or whatever. They've got the family, the dogs, the surfing, they're doing stuff, they're making music. And so it's great, really. We're all linking together, and really, my people enjoy my success. You get two types of people in this world. You get the people who get bitter about people doing well, and you get the people who are willing you to do better. And that's the kind of fans I've got. They're actually willing me to go further, and I really appreciate that.
Well, there was a guy actually on your Instagram, speaking of your social media, who actually spoke eloquently about possibly contemplating suicide and how your music kind of brought him back from the edge.
Yeah.
How do you deal with stuff like that, man? How do you?
Well, I think it could be, you know, that day it happened to be him and me making that connection. But it can happen with so many different artists, you know what I mean? It can happen, it's not just exclusive, obviously, to me. You know, I've been told in Italy, I remember a young girl was in a coma for a long time, and her mum just played a Bittersweet Symphony because it was her favourite song before she went into the coma, and she came out of the coma, and they turned up at the concert to tell me that they believed the song had helped her come back into consciousness and stuff, and it's huge stuff.
Yeah.
You know, it's very difficult to comprehend, but the reason why I then wrote a song back in 2000, whatever, called Music is Power, because I started to hear all these stories. Mm. I started to see grown men crying at concerts. I started to see lads who are tough lads who, a bit like me, when they were young, probably a bit emotionally repressed or in an environment where showing a lot of emotion probably wasn't, you know, the done thing.
Yeah.
And I think music in that way as well can be incredibly powerful as an outlet,
because
so, you know, I don't deal with it. I'm just happy that the guy didn't kill himself, because I think there's a sort of suicide-y culture growing around. And I think when you see someone of my age with a family and a good band or a successful career, and then they suddenly we find out that they've killed themselves,
it sends
a terrible negative shockwave around the world, and not only to people who are striving or probably struggling, then they start thinking, well, guy, if that guy couldn't make it through, what hope have I got?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think it's important in that way is to sometimes try and, like, not be unreal about the pain in life and death, but offer a little bit of something, a bit of a crack of light, you know what I mean? Because it'd be easy just to make music that just hit, smack you in the face. You know, like Bittersweet Symphony, first line, you're a slave to money, then you die. I can't get any more powerful and sort of in your face than that.
Yeah.
Yet we celebrate that together with my fans. We celebrate that I'm not broke, I'm not out of that. You know, of course, you know, success has brought me a certain sense of freedom that I never had when I was skint. You know, I can walk through a woods and no one's telling me to get out. I can light a fire in my own wood. Things like that. You know, the crazy stuff that you would never imagine that you'd be able to do when you were young, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's all good. It's a very, very messed up world at the moment. It's very painful. And at my age, I either hear about a birth or someone's ill or someone's dead.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's a real... This is man time. This is where you're going to man up and be real about life and be real with your audience and your music and try and inspire them and elevate them out of this quagmire of mess, you know?
Well, your last kind of album put a little bit of a mirror up to, you know, revolution and social anguish and stuff like that. This time round, it's a little bit more joyful, isn't it? You are surprised by the joy and you're emitting it quite a lot as well.
Absolutely, because These People was almost like a culmination of someone who for years had been studying what was going on beyond just music. The mechanics of the world, the power structure of the world. And then when I started to realize that people were being divided into sections, not only in England, all over Europe, in America, on political and, you know, even race, I found it really distasteful, actually, and wrong and negative, because a lot of the hashtag brigade fighting for the justice of women or fighting for this cause or that, they're actually very divisive people. You know, even Lily Allen said something about me the other day, and she even mentioned the colour of my skin. I mean, I can't get my head around that. Like, why someone who's supposedly trying to bring people together, I don't know what her role in life is, but, you know, when someone starts mentioning the colour of your skin and your class or where you're, it's very divisive, highly divisive. This country don't need it. This country needs bringing together. When I play the Barrowlands in Glasgow, I bring people together of different faiths, different footballing fans. That's the power of music. Music's not about people going around making people more separate. We have a common humanity, and it isn't based on a political party. It isn't based on our skin. It isn't based on anything. It's called the human race. So this record's probably potentially in places a little bit more of a, you know, a celebration of the fact that amongst all this crap, you know, a hug off someone you love, a nice walk, a cup of tea, the sunset, whatever, can actually be a cure for the malaise which a mind like mine is left in when you're left thinking, wow, we are so divided now that can we ever come together as a people? And we are being manipulated, and we are being manipulated by the media, manipulated by everyone to start looking at each other differently. And I can't stand that. So whether this record's more about love, I hope it is. I hope it gives people a good feeling. But the last track on the record, Money, Money, is a statement. It's the final statement to all the fakes, all the imposters, all those people taking a big slice of pie away from the real musicians, the young people who want to be their own bosses, write their own songs, be in charge of their own destiny. We no longer want these cheesy bosses telling us how to make music. We don't want anyone writing music for us. We want to dress ourselves, because this is England, this is Britain. We are the greatest at that. We are the people that brought culture, musically, pop culture, to the world. We took something that was dead in the water in America and repackaged it, took it back to America, and we changed America. And let me say this to Lily Allen. The Beatles were the first people to stop a segregated concert in America. Four white Liverpool working class boys would not play a segregated concert. That's power. That's music. It's not a hashtag. It's actual practically doing something for the cause of other people. So don't anyone out there get on my back again to sell your pathetic little book.
But I think in many ways, part of what she was presumably trying to grab at was the idea that marginalized groups, BME members, women.
No, she wasn't. She's trying to sell a book. She's skint. She doesn't care for them. No? I've done more for women than she has. I've made more grown men cry, and that's important for womandom.
Let's get to the music anyway. Do you still get the...
Yes, I do.
...butterflies
when yes. you release No, I don't get butterflies, no.
When
I
you,
get,
when,
I just,
when
I don't know what you, I don't call them butterflies, it's just excitement.
But yeah, so when you got a new album out.
Yeah, I don't get excited about trolling over the same crap again though, talking about The Verve or Oasis or what do you think about this? No, I don't get excited about that. I'm excited about my fans hearing it, that's all I care about. I don't care about anyone else. I care about me, my fans, that's it. As long as they are inspired by it and enjoy it and say, Rich, you know what I mean, I'm loving the record, that's all I care about.
But isn't that the point that when the critics don't matter?
Critics don't matter, critics never mattered. Why would they still be sat here? They tried to slaughter me for 20 years. This country's a disgrace, what it does to its great artists. Radio 1, you have had an apartheid on some of the greatest songwriters of this country. 20 odd years, you haven't played people because they're too old in the morning. So you've brainwashed the youth of the nation by playing them your selective little age group music instead of showing them the lineage of this great country, you know, and playing great new acts next to something that actually has some worth. So I got no respect, not only for the critics, you know, and I'll tell you one thing, and I've said it before, I have never had a bad review off a good looking person. It's serious. I've never had a bad review of someone who I look at and I think, wow, you're stunning. You know, every time I look at these guys' faces, I'm like, yeah, fair enough. I'll give you that. Because I'm me and you're you. And I'll give you that because I'd hate me if I was you too.
Well, it's a good job I'm f***ing handsome, isn't it?
Gorgeous.
You are going to be heading out on tour in 2019 quite early. It's a pretty extensive tour. How has things changed for you touring in 20 years as a solo artist?
As a solo artist, I've just got the best band I've ever had. I've got the best atmosphere. I've got the best drive of a team behind me. I've got the best fans. I've got a better voice than I had when I was younger. I'm a better performer. I'm stronger. You know, it's better than ever. So I'm just so excited to me, you know, to be playing these shows in the next few weeks and also next year playing the Olympia in London, 10,000 indoor. You know, it's all good, man. It's all good. It's just like, it's all meant to be. It's all written. You know what I mean? All my downs, all everything's all part of the story. You got to learn from. You can't always be the, you know, the favorite. I've always been an outsider, man. People have always tried to box me into something. When I first started, I was like with, you know, for some reason our band were put in with Suede, and then we were put in with something else. And I'm hanging off a roof, and they're calling us shoegazers. I'm bringing down the roof in New York at 21 years old and calling me a shoegazer, yeah? And then they called me Mad Richard for years. Every single time I did an interview, they would prefix what I said with Mad Richard.
Yeah.
And then they would do slang. They changed the words that I would say in order to me sound more what they thought was Northern. All these things would never happen now because we live in PC world. Don't forget to visit PC World and get that brand new computer because that's where we're living right now. So I've lived through that. And now we've got all the hashtaggers, mental illness, mental awareness. We've got to be aware of mental. But, you know, it was cool back then to call me Mad Richard all the time. And do you know what? That was a fucking compliment. Because if you ain't mad in this planet, then you ain't living. You're not breathing. I'm happy with that moniker, you know. And in fact, I'm madder now than I was then, you know. In this stale place that we're in. I'm a rock and roll star, was born to do this, and that's what I'll always do. And whether people get it or not, I don't give a f***.
Man United. Can we talk a little bit about football very, very briefly?
If we have to, yeah. Greatest team ever. Spirit is incredible. I could manage them. I could sort it out. Obviously, I haven't got the certificates. I just asked Paul Scholes to come back. I'd ask Ryan Giggs to help me. But I really am a good man manager, and no one would take. You know, there'd be no shit.
Well, after some of the speeches that I've witnessed personally today, you know, you're certainly an evocative.
Well, you know, if things had gone differently, then I wouldn't have been saying what I said today. If things in the first couple of weeks of me releasing what I believe is a positive, beautiful song hadn't happened, if I hadn't had the fake news attack me, if I hadn't had someone Photoshop a bag of crack cocaine coming out my trousers after I told the people of the country that if they were budding musicians to turn the X Factor off, you know, that had 500,000 views in a matter of no time. But it's funny, isn't it, that the fake news hit only 24 hours later. Mm. So I'm right in the middle of this right now, and I don't care who understands the battle for the heart of this country's musical soul. I don't care if you switch the X Factor on and you think Robbie and his wife and Simon and everyone are the bee's knees and you love it. I'm telling you right now, it's got nothing to do with music. This is just entertainment. That is showbiz, baby. And not only that, they even make Rolls Royces look uncool.
But the fact that when stuff like that, Soccer AM, the X Factor thing,
it just
gets shared around so you know, it goes around so quickly, so virally.
You mean someone who faked up a picture and then put a ring around it and then all the national press run with it without analysing that it wasn't even the same trainer. It wasn't even the same shoe.
So
how does that affect a man when his auntie's you're burying his Mexican auntie on the Wednesday, and you've got people coming out of the woodwork who should know f***ing better, spreading bile, and you know who you are as well?
So you get that kind of, you're in the middle of that kind of
I'm in the middle of something that no one in this room understands. So there's no point even trying to actually try and give you words for what I've just been through. I've been through full-on warfare, and I come out like, what, Muhammad Ali? That's where I've come out like, Bruce Lee. I just wiped the floor with these people, but it took a lot of energy to do it when I should have had that energy to prepare for the tour, you know, etc.
Mate, I think you got the reserves to do so. I think you got the reserves to destroy.
I want to thank Absolute Radio for playing my music. God bless you. Absolute Radio, keep on playing it. Keep on playing good music, because there's hardly anyone else doing it.
Well, Richard, thank you for speaking to us, and thank you for your candor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, man.